Hello, everyone. It is 8 a.m. here in New York. Wonderful to see that we already have participants both from the United Kingdom and from Senegal and here in the United States as well. We would really love to know where everybody is dialing in from. We really see these webinars as a way for people to connect with each other on the chat box, along with learn from experts doing great work in the field and on various topics. So I'm going to get started right away, just because I want to make sure that we have plenty of time for our actual speakers today. This is Marnie Sommer. I'm here in New York City. And okay, more popping up from Germany and India. Wonderful. Please continue to fill the chat box and let us know who you are and what country you're dialing in from. That way we're also mindful of the time zones that everybody is in. So with no further ado, today is the first Period Posse Presents webinar of the new season. This is our third season, which is kind of amazing to me. So really delighted to be back here. Oh, wonderful also to see what time it is in India, where you are. So that's great. Okay, so I'm going to dive right in. Today, we're going to hear about periods in sports, which is really fantastic. We've never covered this topic. And I think really it is one of the very under-addressed issues. So I think it's really wonderful that we have people able to talk to these issues today. So first, as I already said, just a welcome back to everybody in as many languages as we could find. We really like to see these webinars as a global community where people who are passionate about periods as we are can find each other, find ways to work together, and also learn, again, as I said, from those out doing the work. Okay, so just a quick review. As I said, this is our third season, but looking back on our 8 webinars from year 2, we had 21 different speakers and attendees from 85 different countries, which was really fantastic. And really, we just love these webinars. And it's great to see all of you, so a lot of familiar names popping up in the chat box. And it's great to see new names as well. In the fall of last year, just as a reminder, for those of you perhaps who are new and want to revisit some of what's recorded and on our website, we had a range of topics in that first fall or the second season. You can see them listed here and you can see the link at the bottom. And I think Caitlin, oh, she's already done it, has put it in the chat box. So if anybody wants to go find these recordings from the fall or those that we had in the spring, again, we had some fantastic speakers from around the world who spoke to these various issues and helped to sort of educate us all on the topics and what we should know about them, what the gaps are, what's being done, and so forth. So just as a reminder, some of you may already know this is our fall season, and you can see the link similarly where you can sign up to get our mailing list so that you will always know when we have another one. But we have some fantastic webinars coming up. Today will be super interesting. And then the next month, we are going to have a new type of webinar where we have lightning talks. We'll have really brief updates from around the world on policies. And then we will take a little stock and look at periods and pandemics, some of the lessons learned over the last year and a half where we've all been sort of online together. And then we will look into and help people to sort of get caught up if it's new to them on contraceptive induced menstrual changes, which is excitingly gaining a lot more attention in the menstruation space and in the family planning space. So it seemed like a really good idea to do a webinar on it and sort of have everybody caught up on what we know. So as I said at the very beginning, before some of you may have joined, wonderful to see we have Zimbabwe and LA and I think probably Sweden and the Netherlands and more countries joining. Please continue to share with us your name and where you are. And if you haven't, just a quick note, some of you are sending your name and your country to hosts and panelists. I think that's the way the Zoom is set up. So if you're going to share with us your name and country, you might want to just fix the chat box so that your who you are goes to everyone. So the reason this slide is up here is that, as I said at the beginning, while we really see these webinars as a way to educate and help people understand some of the critical and new issues out there or things that are being doing on certain topics, we also see it as a way for you all to connect, which is why we really encourage you to share who you are and where you are in the chat box to everyone, so that you can find each other if you're working in the same country or if you find that you're working on similar issues. And so we will similarly encourage you to put in the chat box resources and other things that you think might be of value or of interest to others who are on here in relation to the topic we're covering. So to continue, just to, for those of you who may be very new to menstruation, and I do love that we have a volleyball player on here with us, which is fantastic. I just like to revisit always the definition, choice of sort of what we're talking about for some of you who may be new to the topic of menstruation and menstrual hygiene management and menstrual health management. So this was the definition that the Joint Monitoring Program put together in 2012. It is a very valuable foundational definition. But over the years, there has been an evolution to a more comprehensive definition and a note, as is written down at the bottom of the screen, that it lacks inclusive language. It really should say all people with periods and not just women and adolescent girls. And so on that note, just a few months ago, colleagues of many of ours published a menstrual health definition, which is wonderful to have out there. This is just the overarching content. There's a much longer sort of pieces and components to it. And there's an open access article out there, which defines it. So really encourage those of you who are new to this space to go and find that article. So key questions, what do we mean by sports? What is there to learn and why do they matter for menstruation? Well, these are all things that we hope to cover today. Our first speaker will cover both the world of more elite athletes, and I think all of us in countries around the world, everyone I've seen join so far, there are elite athletes, sort of high level athletes that are training to compete at the national level and or in the Olympics at the global level. But there are also everyday young people engaging in sports or who might benefit from engaging in sports. And so there's a lot to learn about where is this integration and intersection of menstruation, whether it is this sort of physiological interaction with our bodies when we engage in physical activity and what it can do for us and also how it can impact your period. And there are also the ways in which engaging in sport can really build self-esteem and confidence and connectivity. And so, so we hope to hear all those things, and I think we will from our two great speakers today. So I just wanted to quickly flag our team here at Columbia University, based in New York and in LA, did some research over the last couple years with girls growing up, low-income girls primarily, and immigrant girls in urban areas of the US. Just to emphasize two quotes, we have one article out and there will be a couple other articles being published hopefully in the coming year. But just to sort of flag that a lot, sort of this quote identifying how girls might skip out of sports practice or not go because they were just uncomfortable with their periods. And so this was from a physical education teacher, which is here in the US, what we might call a teacher in secondary school or middle school, sort of upper primary, who teaches kids physical activities. Similarly, this was from an adolescent girl in Los Angeles, just hearing, so both hearing from the coaches who work with the girls and also hearing from the girls themselves, the fear and anxiety around not wanting to participate or fear when participating in exercise, that somehow blood would show on their shorts. Someone might see their pad and how embarrassing that would be. And so more is found in the article below, and Caitlin kindly just shared it in the chat box if people want to read it. But clearly there is much to be investigated and done about the issue of menstruation and sports. So finally, the last slide, we always like to have some quote from someone wiser than ourselves on these webinars. But this quote from Nelson Mandela, that sport has the power to change the world. It has the power to inspire. It has the power to unite people in a way that little else does. It speaks to youth in a language they understand. And so I think there really are wonderful ways that we can engage with sport and menstruation moving forward. So just a few reminders. Again, wonderful. I'm so enjoying both talking to you and reading where everybody is from in the chat box and seeing your platforms that you're sharing. Please continue to do that. We really hope people find each other on these webinars. We will at the very end share the speaker contact information so that if you want to follow up with either of them, you will know how to reach them. And then we also will have a Q&A session after the two speakers. For those of you participating, you obviously have the chat box open, which is fantastic. There should also be on your Zoom link a Q&A box. So if you could also open your Q&A box, that is where we'd like you to insert any questions that you have for our speakers, and they will try to answer them as we go along. But we will also refer to the Q&A box at the very end when we take questions and pose them to our two wonderful speakers. So along with your chat box, we just encourage you to open your Q&A box. Okay, wow, everything from South Sudan to Scotland to Ohio in the United States. I'm incredibly excited. Okay, so, and then for tweeting, if you are on social media and you're tweeting so we can spread the word about learning from these webinars and also about what we're hearing today, please go for it. Take screenshots or any of the quotes you hear from the speakers, and there are some hashtags you can use at the bottom. So we have two wonderful speakers today who I'm gonna move right into introducing so that we don't waste any more time. And so, Georgie, I'm just going to give you remote access. Give me 1 second. And okay, you should have access. And just if you could unmute yourself, oh, you've already unmuted yourself.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. I will just click to, yeah, there we go. Firstly, yes, it's so great to speak to everyone today. And I'm so excited to talk about a topic that I'm obviously so passionate about. And hopefully today I will just work through some of the work that we've done. And I guess like what we have learned so far, I'm very mindful that we're really only at the beginning of this journey, and there's so many things that we want to do and keep progressing, but it's really great to talk to you today and I guess explain where we're at and where we want to go, and hopefully you'll all join us on our journey, and you know, we can all work together, because I think in this space we have to work together to drive change. Okay, so tiny bit of background actually. I work for a company called Orico, and I'm also an academic researcher, so I really combine applied science with research. So I feel in many ways I'm really lucky to be able to translate or try and translate what we see in research into my applied world, but then also use the applied world to inform what I think is really needed from a research perspective. And we all know that more research in the female space, full stop, is very much needed, and all the more so in the female athlete space. Okay, so I just wanted to start with a few headlines that have really sort of taken come to the fore over the last 5-6 years. So up until around 2014, 2015, it obviously the menstrual cycle in terms of sport was really not discussed. The menstrual cycle full stop was really not discussed. Still, as we all know, there's limited discussion in this space, but I guess there was a real sudden pickup from the media in 2015 with some really gripping headlines highlighting how the menstrual cycle really held some of these tennis players initially back, and this swimmer who spoke out publicly. Now, if you really read some of these headlines, "Why Can't Men Face the Truth? Period. Sabotage Our Lives." Heather Watson spoke publicly about it last week, but why is there still a taboo? Now, I mean, it's amazing that this is being discussed. However, I look at these headlines and I think, wow, what barriers are we creating for our athletes, for our everyday woman who wants to exercise? We're actually reinforcing this taboo, and we're highlighting that yes, you can't actually perform consistently, and this menstrual cycle can hold you back. So while it is all well and good that this has been discussed, I feel like the messaging here is not ideal, particularly when we're trying to get the world active and help people to be fit and healthy. Now, I guess on the back of this, I was very fortunate because those media articles came out at about the time that I was starting my PhD. So they really created this drive and momentum to really conduct some more research in this area, but to also try and work collectively across the world to drive change. Now, I thought initially I'd just share some of the data from the research that we have actually been conducting with a number of different partners around the world. So, as you can see, sorry about the slightly faded map, but I'm going to overlay some statistics. As you can see, that we've so far done a fair bit of research across some different countries around the world, from European countries to North American countries, South American, Brazil specifically, and Australia and New Zealand. Obviously, we need to get so much more of a global reach in terms of research, but I thought I'd just highlight some headlines that we've come up with so far. And this is across both the elite and the recreational everyday woman population. So menstrual cycle symptoms are really common. Now, I think, again, in the past, we don't talk about this. We haven't spoken about this. We often speak internally to our families, maybe, where there's a genetic predisposition to certain menstrual dysfunctions or even certain symptom types. So we often don't know that there's loads that can be done to manage menstrual cycle symptoms, but actually, we know that symptoms are really common. We also know that from an exercise perspective, one in three women actually have to change their training due to these menstrual cycle symptoms. Whether it's your elite athlete or your recreational athlete, training has to be changed as a result of the severity of symptoms. We know that two-thirds of women feel that symptoms affect their performance. Now, interestingly, this isn't just their sporting performance. This is performance in all aspects of life, whether it's performance in work, performance in the family life, performance just being who you want to be. We know that symptoms can be very debilitating and affect that. Now, of those athletes who are coached, 90% do not speak to their coach about their menstrual cycle. So 66 are feeling that their performance is limited, yet 90% don't speak to their coach about it. And from my perspective, working in the elite world, as I do probably 75% of the time, that real disconnect is a big problem, because coaches are sitting there scratching their heads, not understanding why their athletes aren't performing, when often this is the missing piece of the puzzle. And it's mind-blowing that we are only really just at a point where we are able to discuss this, and many people still aren't. Heavy bleeding is really common. Again, I think many people, and there are lots of issues with the diagnosis of heavy bleeding, but heavy bleeding is common, and many people normalize that. They don't realize that their situation may be abnormal because, again, there's often family links there, or genetic components to it. So it's not something you typically talk about to your friends and other friend, other colleagues. So really trying to raise awareness around what heavy menstrual bleeding is very much needed. And then 85% of people perceive there to be insufficient menstrual cycle knowledge. We actually, when we specifically look at recreational women, that goes up to more like 90%. And so we know globally there is a lack of appreciation, full stop, in this space. And that's something which I guess is a real part of our mission moving forwards to try and tackle and change. So I guess on the back of doing that research, what are we now doing, and what have we now been doing to try and drive change and to change the game for women in sport across the whole pathway, from elite right the way down to grassroots? So we know that so much more research is needed. As I already highlighted, research really needs to be front and center. And we need our experiences in the field to also dictate that research and to highlight the real problems that have been experienced. So, as I previously highlighted, 95% of people actually experience menstrual cycle symptoms. Well, how many people know that certain types of exercise really help with the management of symptoms? What you're eating really can influence the types and severity of symptoms that you can get. We've seen in the last year huge amounts of stress and changes in lifestyle related to the coronavirus. And actually, that's exacerbated many people's symptoms and changed their menstrual cycle characteristics as a whole. So I think really trying to understand all of the multifactorial influences that elements of your life can have on your menstrual cycle, but also how the menstrual cycle can impact your readiness to be the best that you want to be. I think that is just so important. And then, of course, education based on that. So we've launched a real outreach campaign, and as part of that, we've created this app, which is Fitter Women, which I'll explain more about. And we're really trying to drive this outreach and education to get as many people out there to understand what's going on in their body, whether it's the elite athlete or the everyday woman or child. Like, I really fundamentally think it's so important to learn more about what you can do to help yourself and what's going on in your body. It's everyone's right as a woman, I think, to learn more. Participation. We know that sport is hugely beneficial from a mental health perspective, but also from a physical health perspective. And again, the coronavirus has taught us how actually being fit and healthy is really beneficial. So I think really trying to engage women and girls and empower them into understanding how their body is working can also drive participation. And finally, performance. So we know from the elite athletes that, as we saw on the first slide, the menstrual cycle can affect performance. But actually, can we reframe that? Can we empower women to actually learn more about what's going on in their body and use this understanding to their advantage? And alongside that, can we facilitate discussion and break down barriers around the fundamentally kind of constructed taboos which don't need to be there anymore? And so we have a couple of real outreach approaches and outreach drives that we've come up with. And the first thing that I wanted to talk to you about was Fitter Women. So I was hugely fortunate at Orico, again, the company I work for, to have been able to develop this free app called Fitter Women. And it is available to everyone and anyone around the world to download totally free. It's on the Apple Store and the Android Store. And essentially, it helps people to track their cycle and learn more about their body. Now, everyone really is different, and I totally appreciate that. So obviously, it's really hard to condense information that's driven, like research driven information, into a mobile application, but we are really passionate about trying to effectively humanize what is going on in the research world and translate that into understanding for everyone and anyone out there, and also help women to see trends and patterns in their own body. I've just put this here because this is just depicting how variable. So this is a typical menstrual cycle. So day one is here, day 28 here, which is an average length cycle, but it can vary from anywhere between 21 and 35 days in a normal menstrual cycle. Throughout that process, hormones are constantly changing, and we really try and educate on that through the app, but it is challenging. And again, everyone is different. And I guess through our app, we've been able to work with the US Women's National Team in the build-up to the World Cup in 2019, which was hugely exciting, but also a number of African nations, particularly actually in football, and I explain that more on the next slide, and a whole group of kind of mass participation individuals. And you know, the real aim of this is to, as much as possible, make research or make education understandable and accessible to as many people out there. Alongside that, you can see this map here of the countries where we have really been driving this education campaign. So we've launched a number of different partnerships. So whether it's working with elite athletes to help them and support them with materials and resources to educate as many people as they can within their networks and within their sport. Also, we've partnered with Strava, the exercise tracking app, to again try and get as many women out there to understand more about the menstrual cycle. We also earlier this year partnered with Adidas to come up with this lesson plan, which is available for free for anyone who wants it, specifically aimed at 10 and 11 year olds to start educating them. It's downloadable on their website, to start educating them about the menstrual cycle. And we've undertaken a number of workshops and webinars and formed a number of partnerships with, particularly specifically initially actually in football, because obviously it's the biggest sport in the world, or soccer, in certain African nations, in oceanic nations as well, to really try and educate almost like top down. So educate the coaches, the national team, with a view to them then spreading the messages far and wide as much as possible. We've also hosted a lot of webinars. We've got a podcast. We've created numerous amounts of video content as well, just to try and get the messaging out there. And I really hope and pray and have my fingers crossed that times are changing increasingly. So, this is just a kind of a few clips of some of the newspaper press or magazine press that has really highlighted that actually, for example, the menstrual cycle shouldn't be a barrier. Actually, using exercise, or shouldn't be a barrier to sport. Exercise can actually be used positively to help manage menstrual cycle symptoms. I've just seen someone's put in the chat that Adidas has created period-proof leggings. Yes, that was a big part of the campaign, and that was really fundamental and exciting that a major brand are finally looking into this. So just in the interest of time, I'm sorry if this is a bit of a whistle-stop tour, but I just wanted to go through a few key takeaways. So firstly, from a practitioner perspective, education is absolutely fundamental to everything. It facilitates discussion and it really helps to break those barriers and taboos. I also think, like, I know it's a daunting conversation to have, but we mustn't be afraid of discussing this area. It is a normal, natural process. It's a sign of health. But more and more, I'm from my perspective, I feel like I'm trying to create these stories of and examples of, elite athletes or well-known people who are engaging in tracking, who are discussing this area, to then try and help use that as a entry to discussing it with other athletes and other girls out there. So if you say, "Oh, did you see what the US Women's National Team did? Oh, actually, why didn't you start learning about your cycle and tracking your cycle?" I really think focusing on everything being as accessible as possible. So obviously I talk about the app we created. There's other apps out there that, for me, just tracking your cycle is important. So in whatever way you do it is great. Of course, there's calendar-based methods as well. There's any way to track your cycle is a starting point, or encouraging people to track the cycle is a really good starting point. And just appreciating that everyone is different, that really is important. And I would also encourage people to monitor over time and understand what is their normal. Look for changes that can really drive insights and understanding. And that's what's been so interesting from my perspective over the last year and a half with the coronavirus. This is just an example of our coach platform where you can track over time. Okay, so then actions from researchers. Obviously, I've highlighted there really is a significant need to drive research. Actually, yesterday we announced a Orica are funding a series of PhDs. We announced a kind of co-funded PhD with FIFA and a university in Australia. So if anyone knows anyone who's interested in doing a PhD, please have a look out for that, because we're really looking for some keen participants or keen researchers or potential researchers. It really is important to appreciate that the menstrual cycle is a whole cycle. Yes, okay, doing research at one time point compared to another time point is useful, but actually, as women, we need to function every day of the cycle. So really understanding how this whole cycle works is fundamental. Methodology is so important when doing research. Conducting hormonal analysis alongside other observations is important too. And it is daunting, and I totally see it is daunting to like try and understand this whole hormonal shift that occurs throughout the menstrual cycle, but that shouldn't put us off. There are so many studies that are needed, and just even starting small and starting with a pilot study even can really help to help other people out there work collaboratively together to really drive this change and to understand this area better. And finally, for policymakers, so I really, really believe that the elite athlete world can be used, and sport can be used as a vehicle for education, so delivering that education and really changing this, like helping girls and women to feel limitless and fearless. Like, we need to really use sport, I think, as a vehicle to deliver education, but also to create these role models, whether it's women coming back postpartum, whether it's women demonstrating that they can perform when they're menstruating or premenstrual. I think that's just so important, and actually I think moving forward that's a really good approach. And we need to empower women for their whole lives. We need to teach them about this menstrual cycle, all aspects of female health, to help them throughout their lives perform and achieve and know what's going on in their body and what they can do about it. And that's everything from me. We have a female athlete podcast if anyone wants to listen and learn more. And then there's a number of social media handles here where people can read more or learn more.
Fantastic. That was, I'm just going to take back the access, but that was really just, as I saw others have said, incredibly interesting and timely, and really just a fantastic presentation. So thank you so much for sharing all that you've learned, even though we didn't give you a lot of time today. It's been really fun as well to watch the chat box. Please remember there is a Q&A box. We are fortunate to have both speakers online as we go along here. So if you have questions, please just enter them in the Q&A box. You can just pull it up on your Zoom, whatever the Zoom control is called. And I'm sure they'll be happy to get back to you with answers. And then we'll also take answers. I can take those questions at the end. I see there's only one so far, but please don't be shy about posing your questions. Okay, so moving along, we are now going to travel to India to hear about an experience really engaging with girls at the intersection of periods and sports. This is gonna be a recording because we were just concerned about connectivity issues. However, Mahima, who is our wonderful speaker, is online and available to answer questions, both in the Q&A box and at the end. And also if you post chats, she will see them in the chat box because she is with us today. So I am just going to start the recording. Here we go.
Hello, everyone. This is Mahima. I'm from India, and it's so good to share our experiences with you. I am from a non-profit organization which is called Slum Soccer. And the name itself, it has what we do. We are working with different parts of the communities in India. The organization, it's a sports-based organization, sports for development organization, and we are working since 2002 in India. We work with children between the ages of 10 to 16. We also train coaches, which are from the local community, the girls and boys, who work with us to deliver our curriculum through football, and the indirect beneficiaries from the program, the parents, teachers, and the local community leaders. This is an image of a girl playing football in a school. So every girl should have the power to do what she wants and feel. And this is how we encourage girls to play football and be an inspiration in the society. And the curriculum focuses on life skills, health, hygiene, and brings an awareness among girls about menstruation and child rights. And it basically focuses on the empowerment of girls from the underprivileged sections of the society. You can see the girls kicking ball and the number slides on the markers. So we are educating them through football and empowering them through educating them through football. Like we said, that there are various challenges when it comes to girls and sports, which the girls face in India, out of which we have selected a few of them. There is a saying in India that girls belong at home, not on the sports field. Girls should cook and look after their home and raise children. That is their role in life. This is what is the conviction of the society in India. And so she's at a very early age, the girls get married. And also the cultural norms which are surrounding them also focuses them to stay at home and not have an equal part or role in the society, especially in sports, because they feel that only boys and men have this privilege of being part of sports. And when it comes to safe places, we see that girls do not feel safe because the community grounds or the playgrounds in school are not having all those facilities. Even a changing room or having washrooms for girls. And that's how the girls feel that, you know, it's really not a good thing to go into schools. They rather stay at home or just do studies in school. They have a double burden because they have to take care of their homes. Sometimes they have to leave education and start working. So when they start working, mostly they are unpaid. They have been told that, okay, you are supposed to do this, you are supposed to take care, and the money is usually kept by the father or somebody who's an authority in the family. Also, there are a lot of violence which the girls normally face in their daily life, like, you know, just walking out of the home. They also face many type of violence, like sexual abuse, emotional abuse, and gender issues. Like we have already discussed that India is powered by men, and girls still cannot raise their voices or take decisions for themselves, and limited access to education, because they say that the girl's role is at home in the kitchen. So why should she get more education? She rather sit at home and learn how to cook and stitch. And the foremost limitation is related to menstruation, where she feels that, okay, her mother or somebody has told her at home that, you know, if you're bleeding, don't exercise or don't run. And, you know, if you stress yourself, you'll not be able to give in your best on the field. And right from that thinking, she's not able to decide whether, even though she's feeling good, she just feels that, no, if I take part in sports, I will, it will get worse. These are the small and big challenges which the girls face. And they are hesitant to take part in sports. This is a quote from a girl who we work with in a school. She's a 15-year-old girl from 9th standard, Lakshmi Raut. And when we just played few games, we used games to open up the girls on the field. And she said that, oh, earlier during my periods, I didn't eat much because girls in school usually just grab in something which is not that nutritious or healthy. But when she played the health race game, she came to know it's important to stay healthy during the periods. Now, when we say that sports for development, and why is it important for girls? The first is games open a dialogue. You just throw a ball on the field and you know that the girls would quickly start, you know, running together and trying to kick a ball. And this is how we feel that if you want to open up a conversation or start something with the girls you want to talk to or pass in a message, especially about menstruation, this is the thing which you can start with by just opening up with some good activities, games. And this helps in sharing. And the girls start sharing what they feel and start sharing their experiences. And this itself starts reducing the stigma around that, you know, girls cannot play during menstruation. The risky behavior is reduced. Some girls would take some kind of a medication and, you know, not consult the doctor just to suppress her periods. And that's when we told her that, you know, we discussed and we tried to counsel the girls that, you know, this is not the way you should be taking care and using medication to suppress it, you know, until and unless it is consulted by a doctor. So these kind of risky behaviors, we have seen examples. that when they are getting involved in sports, we could start a dialogue and start interacting on these important aspects. Sports is a very good way for helping the girls to start remaining active. So sports definitely plays an important role in the physical, emotional well-being. This is a wonderful way for opening a dialogue and, you know, just start talking and communicating that, you know, menstruation is not a taboo. And so sports is a very good medium to open up the girls and start conversations about menstruation. So when we had our monitoring and evaluation for the project which we were working in, there were a number of findings from the monitoring and evaluation which we did with the girls, and these were like, you know, the increased menstrual hygiene knowledge. So we saw that girls started realizing that yes, menstruation is a normal process, whereas when we talked to them before the project started during the baseline, they saw it as a very different process. They thought that they were impure when they had their menstruation. They were told that they were not clean. And after the process, the end line, we came to know that 71% girls saw that periods is a normal process, and it was wonderful to know that, you know, girls are changing their perception and overcoming restriction and taboos. So like we said, there are n number of taboos which were being discussed and restrictions which the girls had, right from playing to not praying in temples. So we after the program ended, nearly 70% of the girls think that restrictions are not justified. They started questioning that why not this, what will happen. And even we have seen girls, instead of telling girls that don't do this, we would have a conversation in a very different way. We would tell the girls, how many of you all do visit the temple and pray? And we would have some girls telling, yes, we did visit when we had our periods. And we would tell those girls to tell these girls that what was their experiences and did something happen? And they would say no. In fact, we felt very good that this is a time we could open up and we could, you know, just go out. And that's the change we saw. And there were improved menstrual hygiene practices, like, you know, 70% started changing pads, cloth more frequently since the training. So right from these small changes and practices, we saw there was a change in 70%, and girls started even calculating their dates, which they didn't know earlier, and creating a supportive structure for girls. This was very much essential for us, because when we talk about sustainability, and we talk about girls having the knowledge and passing it on to others, we wanted to create a supportive structure. And we saw that 76% of the girls found it very easier to talk it to any of their female friends. Include women voices. It's important that women are included in every decision making, whether it's at a national level, at a municipal level, at a school level, women should be heard. They are the ones who bleed. So if policymakers would just help in women to speak and have these kind of places where they could speak and, really speak about menstruation, what are the simple policies that could be made into. Like in India, during the COVID situation, the sanitary pads were not included as a part of essentials, and women and girls were struggling even to get sanitary pads. So, you know, just this small decision, if any would have told them that, you know, during the lockdown, if this could also be given and provided from house to house, it would have made made their lives much more easier. Donors play a very important role. The support is what we need, you know, to improve the ability to advocate for the needs of the women and girls. So all the programs which the donors sponsor us help us to bring about a change in every girl, in every girl's life. And they are just not sponsoring a program, they're changing their life. So this is a takeaway to the donors who are listening and who would like to sponsor more programs for menstruation. Every bit is going to contribute to the nation and to the women at large. A very big message to everyone, you know, to support girls and women just to feel safe and, you know, have a stress-free environment. Just talk to them. You might be a father, you might be a brother or just a friend. Just be around. And this is something which is a very important aspect of the life of women and girls, that their life revolves around menstruation. And this is going to be with them. So if you're there around, just be with them and make them know that you are there and they're really special. Thank you so much.
Wonderful. Another...
Hello, everyone. This is...
Another fantastic presentation. I feel like we've gotten such a range of insights from our two speakers today. And I've really enjoyed watching the conversation back and forth and everybody sharing their own perspectives and their own experiences and their own programming sort of related insights. We've had a very active Q&A box, which has also been wonderful. So just to flag what some of the questions were, if you haven't opened the Q&A box, I'm not going to read the answers, but there was a question about, has there been more research in low and I assume middle income countries? And so I think there's been less of that research. So there's a lot of work for us all to do. There's questions around how the curriculum how it may help athletes or coaches to know what is normal, abnormal bleeding, which Georgie's work does. There are questions around if there's a causal relationship related to hormones and sort of menstrual cycle symptoms, and I think in relation to sport. And so there's a good long answer there from Georgie with some links. There's also questions around sort of how do we better access younger girls who really don't understand menstruation and the cycle. And again, Georgie has included some answers, but our own team develops puberty books for girls who are 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 to help them feel more confident about their bodies. And I know a number of other organizations are doing that work, but we certainly haven't been doing it in relation to sports, although we do put girls engaged in sports on all the covers of the puberty books that we do through Grow and Know alongside of our work at Columbia. Similarly, some questions around the intersection with contraceptives and also if there's a link in relation to sort of those who get their period at a younger age, which is something we similarly have wanted to know more about. For those who reach their first period or menarche early, what are the implications? Not just the question here is about sports dropout, but I think we also wonder what are the links with child marriage and teen pregnancy, and so on. So there's also a question that Louise has posed around if there's any research on menstrual cup use in relation to weightlifting. I'm going to let maybe Georgie respond to that in the chat box. It's already been answered. She hasn't answered that one yet. These are being answered so quickly, I can't pose them. What I would like to ask our panelists to each answer is maybe one at a time, just a question I had. Georgie, you could go first, and then Mahima. What is the role of sort of parents and caregivers in relation to whether it's elite athletes or girls engaged in programming? Sort of what of the engagement that you have found, what is the role of parents and caregivers in terms of being willing to think about these issues, permit their young people to engage in the sports or to better understand themselves issues of menstruation so they can support those who menstruate, their children who menstruate. So I don't know, Georgie, if you have any thoughts on that, if that's come up at all in your research.
Yeah, that is such a good question, actually. So I would say that parents and caregivers actually have a massive part to play here in the normalization and the education. We often come across athletes who are frightened by the menstrual cycle, overwhelmed by it, intimidated by it, and they are typically those who have it just hasn't been a discussion point at home. So I really believe that education, there needs to be kind of a double-pronged approach. So education for youngsters has to be in parallel with education for parents. And I really, really hope that times are increasingly changing and that more people are understanding that this is a normal, natural area of discussion, and that actually, discussing it at home is very much a thing that can be done. But I also think the way it is discussed and framed is also so important. And that, obviously we've heard today in the second and very inspiring presentation from Mahima about how almost barriers can be kind of artificially constructed or constructed without necessarily the background understanding. So I think it's so important to help parents and caregivers understand, and as many people out there understand, that the menstrual cycle doesn't need to be a barrier. It's not that you can't exercise when you're menstruating. And I know that's really challenging, and I know that, even in the UK we can't get that right. So I globally I know that is a real challenge. But I think, again, like back to my real focus of, like, I guess learning from the elite world, like if we demonstrate every nation who plays football, for example, that they can openly talk about the menstrual cycle, and actually they can play soccer when they are on their period, then I really hope that parents and caregivers will see that, and then young girls and athletes can see that and then feel that they can be limitless and fearless too. I think obviously the period poverty component and the accessibility of sanitary products is also something that we can't forget here, and I know that is a real challenge, but at least, like, they say you can't be what you can't see. So at least if people can see people exercising at any point, being the best that they want to be in whatever part of their life or whatever career they're undertaking, then I think that will hopefully help, and over time it will improve. But I do think normalization is just fundamentally important.
Great. And I think probably we would all totally agree with you that it's not one thing, that we need to do. It is the normalizing, breaking the stigma, talking about it in much more open ways, along with making sure young people have the education and also the supplies they need, and also the private spaces for changing and bathing and so on. Before I just look to some of the other questions, and I'm also cognizant of time, Mahima, did you have any comments or thoughts you might want to make in relation to the role of parents or caregivers for engaging the girls in India in the program?
Yes, sure. Thank you so much. It was wonderful to hear to Georgie and the research work which she has done. Like I said, menstruation is a complete cycle, right from the time the girl gets her first periods, which is menarche. She needs to be mentally prepared for it. And the time the parents, the caregivers, especially the teachers, the educators, the coaches, start taking this note that, we need to be prepared, and we need to focus on educating her first. And that's when the dialogue opens, and that's when her thoughts open, and she just feels there is somebody whom I can talk to, and she is mentally prepared for it. And that's how the cycle starts. Whereas in India, mostly it happens in the rural parts, where it is still considered as impure or a taboo, and the girl is kept locked in a dark room,
and she's kept there because she has her periods for those 3 to 4 days. And there is no conversation still. And if her mother also gets her period, she's also supposed to be there with her. And the father or somebody in the house, the male member, passes on the food, or she's not allowed to go to the temple. So all these starts with education. So the more we educate and more we involve the parents and involve them in our programs, and that's what we do in our sports program, where we involve the mothers, the local leaders, and also our male coaches. The time the girls menstruate, the coaches do know that they do not need to take a very aggressive warm-up, and they just talk to the girls, and the girls feel free to tell their periods date. So the more you educate and provide a positive environment, that's when the conversation starts and the girls really feel that they have somebody to talk to. So giving a positive environment is very important, and start thinking about how the period affects the girl in the complete cycle. And the parents have understood that the more they support, the more they see the girl, getting, trying to achieve her goals, and the more she tries to communicate with them. So these are my thoughts on it.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. And those were excellent responses to the question. There's some more I'm not going to go through, because I just, in the interest of time, there are questions around engaging boys and men, which is Georgie responded, their programming does that, and similar to our puberty books, which we also do for boys. And some great questions around how do we engage male coaches and others in the conversation. So just noting that it's late in the world for some of you, I just want to wrap up our webinar at this point, but with a couple more slides for those of you who are still with us. First, please remember to sign up if you are not already sort of registered for all of our webinars. There will be many more coming. And if you sign up or go to our website, you can also see all the past ones so that you can listen in and learn from all the great speakers we've had over the last 2 years. We also welcome ideas. We're always trying to find new topics to cover and great speakers out there. So please do let us know if you have ideas. And please also share with your network so that we can continue to grow the world of people connecting and talking to each other about periods and how we can really transform these issues. Coming up next month, we will have, as I said at the very beginning, these lightning talks on updates on policies from around the world. And then the final slide, just to say, here is our contact information, along with our terrific speakers' contact information, who I just want to thank again for doing such a fantastic job today, speaking and covering these important issues that really, as both acknowledged, and many of you have commented, have been far too unaddressed over the years. So I'm so incredibly excited that we now are talking about it. And also many thanks to the GATE team, Caitlin, and also Maggie Schmidt, who's behind the scenes helping us come up with ideas for what we should include.